and moving outside of that body. And I think that Bob Monroe, well, tell us the story. Yeah, you tell us. I talk too much.
Yeah, the story of his first out-of-body experience, he had various physical, well, as he reported it later in his book, he reported having certain sort of, if you like, physical disturbances beforehand. When looking back on this, I don't know that they were particularly relevant. They could have happened anyway. But his very first experience was quite a simple one, and at the same time, terrifying. He was in bed next to his wife, and his hand was lying, you know, over the side of the bed, and he felt it almost as if it was going through the floor, and he could feel water. And he had no idea what this was. Was this a dream? What was happening? And to begin with, he wasn't convinced whether it was a dream, whether it was was he being ill? Was something wrong with him mentally? He couldn't make any sense out of it. And then he had an experience very shortly after that when he found himself, in effect, floating on the ceiling, and looking down, he could see a body in bed with his wife. And into that body, lying there, he himself, as it were, entered back to where he should be. These very simple early out-of-body experiences were actually confined to the room. But within a short time, he found himself moving outside. Now,
outside meaning outside of the room.
Outside the confines of the bedroom and outside the confines of the house. As it were, visiting the neighborhood, you could put it like that. And when he came to look at this later, he called these experiences Locale 1. Locale 1. And these were sort of, if you like, trips around the neighborhood. Now, it's interesting that if you go back to the literature before Bob Monroe, and he had never read any of this literature, and it's quite hard to find it, but if you go back to that, you do find that a lot of those recorded cases before Bob were like that, people finding themselves apart from their body, out of their body, somewhere in the neighborhood, somewhere nearby. Nothing dramatic, nothing out of the ordinary. In fact, you might be walking down the street or whatever it was, but actually the physical body was lying in bed. Now, of course, you can confuse this with dreams, and it sometimes is quite tricky to disentangle the out-of-body experience from a dream. But those people who do experience it, and also the scientists who have looked into this, find that after a while these experiences become quite separate. We don't confuse them anymore.
It is amazing. We're going to take a break now. When we come back, I want you to continue talking about that and what happened in this locale and what it's more about and that sort of thing. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We're speaking with Ronald Russell, and he's the author of a new book, The Journey of Robert Monroe, From Out-of-Body Explorer to Consciousness Pioneer. My name is Virato, and you're listening to Virato Live on 880 The Revolution.
You're listening to an exclusive 880 AM The Revolution podcast. You can listen live, check out the latest news, get host info, downloads, and more at 880therevolution.com.
Now expand your consciousness as the revolution continues with Virato Live, bringing you a holistic viewpoint, a different revolution of sorts.
And we're back with author Ronald Russell, his new book, The Journey of Robert Monroe, From Out-of-Body Explorer to Consciousness Pioneer. I wanted to make one correction. When I was doing the intro, I indicated that Bob's book was Journey Out of the Mind, Far From It. Journey Out of the Body is the correct, and that happened to become his best seller. Before the break, so you were telling us he went out and up into the top of his room, and then he went outside of that into what you call Locale 1. Now, you're figuratively saying your local neighborhood, right? Because it's something different than that, is it not?
It's, well, in effect, it was a local name. These are the names he gives it.
Okay.
And he divided his experiences, his early experiences, into three locales. One was, and I would explain this as local traffic, and then after that you get into something that is quite different. Locale 2 and Locale 3 are quite different types of experience, and I think in many ways very much they're very much more interesting, in fact.
Well, you can't tell us about it, can you? I mean, I tried, you know, Bob did tell, when I by the way, I may not have mentioned this on the air, but I interviewed him back in 1994, and then during the interview he said this to me, and I may share this with you. He had had more than one wife, yeah, but this last relationship was very, very deep, and he felt it was deeper than on this so-called physical plane. And then when she passed over, he would be going out. I guess this was Locale 3, would that be correct?
No, it isn't. No. I can talk about that.
All right, let's talk about that.
He actually drops this division when he's writing late. The whole type of out of body experience develops during the remainder of his life.
Well, that's 10 years, right? Right. He had that reputation. He would send out memos, as you said in your book. He put out memos and whatever, and the next day they could well change. So he was quite a spontaneous man too, and.
Yes.
Kind of a, well, he's entrepreneurial. A guy made many, many fortunes. Today, I guess he'd be called a multi-billionaire.
Yes.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, so tell us now, as I said, when I interviewed him, he said that he didn't want to go out again because he felt that if he did, he simply would not come back.
That is true, yes.
You know, because he said, you know, why? And if everything that we read about him in all his books and all the articles or whatever, and, you know, go to that website, by the way, monroeinstitute.com. And I trust that it hasn't been watered down or anything. But, you know, if you're out there listening right now and, you know, you're really sold on Hare Krishna or Jesus Christ or whatever your trip is, I don't think Robert Monroe's thing was to make that change. He was just giving you raw data of what is. If you happen to see it as spiritual, that was your trip. He never saw it that way, and I think that's why he is still respected, and even more so he needs to be, I think. But go ahead now. You tell us more about the locales. And so anyway, he didn't come back, and I assume he's out there. Bob, I hope you're having a good time, and you're influencing this, and I know that this is Clear Channel Broadcasting. This is biggest, and I'm in the most sophisticated studio. I'm actually broadcasting from the most sophisticated radio studio probably in the United States of America. Bob's dream, because, you know, we never mentioned his background, but he owned radio stations, didn't he?
Yeah, Bob was he had an interesting childhood. He was quite precocious. He developed sort of fixations, flying trains. He once spent a year as a hobo riding the rails. he decided eventually that he wanted to work in radio. He spent a long time sending out ideas and scripts, getting nowhere, moved up to New York. He shared a room with three would-be actors. They all lived in one room. They went out looking for work, and he spent his time writing scripts.
Mm-hmm.
While all this was going on, he had three very short-lived marriages. In all, he had certainly four wives. I think five is the acceptable, the accurate number. But by 1950, when he was 35, he was right at the top of the radio world with 28 primetime shows a week.
Wow.
He was the vice president of Mutual Broadcasting. He had a fine house, fast cars. He owned broadcasting stations.
A good-looking guy, too, by the way.
He was a terrific go-getter.
Yeah.
And the one thing that was different was this interest in learning while you were asleep, sleep learning. And he got half a dozen or more people to practice this with a certain amount of success. And one of them was his own daughter, Laurie.
Right.
And he would recite to her